Non ci ho sentito neanche. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وإمام المتقين وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا والسماء بناء وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون. وإن كنتم في ريب مما نزلنا على عبدنا فأتوا بسورة من مثله وادعوا شهداءكم من دون الله إن كنتم صادقين. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. ربي زدنا علما بالقرآن العظيم وبسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحمد لله. Today is the eighth lesson of the tafsir that we have on Monday. Even though a person spends time disobeying Allah, a person goes against the commands of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still gives tawfiq, an ability to spend some time discussing the words of Allah without trying to even sound like I'm being humble or I'm trying to show that I'm being humble. The reality is, in my life, if I'm being very honest with you all, when I look into the book of Allah and I look into the hadith, though I may be studying, I may be teaching it, I swear by Allah and I make an oath in the name of Allah, such an oath that I won't need to give kafara for. I swear by Allah, I am myself very far. I myself am very far from the deen of Allah. I myself am very far from the teachings of the Quran. It's very easy to speak regarding the book of Allah, but to be a physical example of the book of Allah, that's the reality. It's very easy to show our face and to show the attitude of a teacher and that we're teaching and we're perfect. But the reality is, in my life, obviously, I have so many faults in my life also. So this tawfiq, an ability to speak regarding the book of Allah, if I look into my life, it's nothing from my side. I don't have any goodness in my life that Allah has allowed me to sit here to speak regarding the book of Allah. Rather, despite all of my faults, it's only through the sheer mercy of Allah. Everything is through the mercy of Allah. I pray that Allah gives us all His mercy, Allah keeps us all sincere, and Allah allows so that in this very world and in the hereafter, Allah continues to hide away our faults. There's a hadith of Sahih Muslim where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that on the day of Qiyamah, Allah will speak to one of His servants and Allah will isolate that servant from the rest of humanity and the rest of His creation. And Allah will say to that servant, "Did you not do such and such a sin?" The person will say, "Na'am, I did." "Did you not hurt such and such a person?" "Yes, I did." "Did you not disobey me at this instant and that instant?" "Yes, I did. Yes, I did. Yes, I did. Yes, I did." It's a private conversation between Allah and this one servant. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that after speaking to him, Allah says, "Did I not hide away them faults? Did I not make it so that people around you weren't aware of your faults? That this person is actually a person who disobeys Allah? Did I not continue to hide away your sins from the people? Did people not still give you honor? Did people still not show respect to you? The person will say, yes, people continue to show respect to me. People continue to honor me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the way I covered your sin in that world, even today, I have isolated you from the rest of mankind. This is a conversation between me and you. The way I made a curtain over your sins, on this day also, to keep your honor, to keep your respect. We have had this discussion, but I will put a curtain away on your sins, and in front of the rest of mankind and humanity, I will show that I have forgiven you. Allah will forgive that person. This is how Allah Ta'ala works with His servants. I pray that Allah makes us amongst those servants, that despite all of our faults, Allah, He puts a curtain over our faults, and Allah grants us all Jannah. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala from verse number 21 says, Ya ayyuhanna su'budu. We've spoken about three categories of people already in Surah Al-Baqarah. For the first category was those believers, those people that believe in Allah. The second category, only two verses, was regarding the disbelievers that openly say, we don't believe in Allah. Thereafter, 13 verses were regarding the hypocrites, those that portray to be a believer, but they're not believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after putting the human being into three categories, now Allah wants to grab everyone back together. Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people. Here is a rule of the glorious Quran. This is the first time in the Quran, Ya ayyuhan nas has come. It is a common explanation of the masters of tafsir. Wherever Ya ayyuhan nas comes, O people. When Allah says in the Quran, I'm addressing the people, we tend to say this is a verse from Makkah. Because in Makkah, Rasulullah was around the believers, the disbelievers. So Allah, when He addresses humanity, He says, O you people, O you mankind. But the verses of Medina, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. So Allah says, O you who believe in Medina verses, and in Makkan verses, Allah says, O mankind. This surah is generally a Madani surah, but because some verses are from Makkah also, but majority are Madani, that's why we call the whole surah Madani surah. So here Allah says, O people, O you believer, O you disbeliever, O you hypocrite. After dividing human beings, Allah now brings everyone back on the same plate. And Allah says, O you people, U'budu Rabbakum. I have only one message for you, O mankind. And that message is, worship your Lord. Worship your Lord, Allah. Who? Alladhi khalaqakum walladhina min qablikum. That Allah, that Lord of yours, who created you. And who created all those before you. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that all those before you? Meaning your forefathers, though they didn't accept Allah, Allah still created them. From Adam alayhi salatu wasalam to this day on, your father, your great-grandfather, and all those before you, every single person that came, Allah created them. If they recognized Him, if they didn't recognize Him, Allah still created them. So Allah says, O people, worship that Lord who has created you. He created all those before you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُوا. So that you may become God-conscious. So that you may realize what it means to please Allah and what it means to stay away from displeasing Allah. In the Arabic language, لَعَلَّ, when it comes, it means in the Arabic language, might. There's some doubt in it that this might happen. So if you were to translate this with that word, لَعَلَّ, meaning might, the translation would become, O you who believe, O you people, worship Allah who created you and those before you, so that possibly you become pious. So this is a very, very big question, that how can Allah say something with a bit of doubt in it? It's not possible that Allah says, so that possibly you become pious, so that possibly you become the muttaqoon, those that have taqwa inside their lives. So here the ulama give the answer. When Allah says la'alla in the Quran, it doesn't come in the meaning of possibility. It means definitely you will become pious. Mm. So in the Arabic language, la'alla is normally used for a bit of doubt, a bit of possibility. But when Allah uses it, it means definitely you will become God conscious. So here Allah is saying, O people, worship me. Worship me, who? Which Allah? The one that's created you. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will explain what He's done for us. And He's going to say in a very general way. As a Muslim, we know Allah's favored us in so many ways. But Allah is speaking to everyone, to people, to mankind. Those that believe in Him and those that don't believe. Those that have strong iman, those that have weak iman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses all of them. So
So Allah will use such examples that inshallah we will be able to all relate to them examples, what Allah is going to say. So Allah says, worship me. If you worship Allah, what will happen? If you are sincere in your worship, you will become pious. You will become piety. By that we mean every sort of worship. The word abdiyat means that you submit yourself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever command Allah has given, Allah said, offer salah 5 times a day. You submit to that. In the month of Ramadan, Allah says, worship me by fasting. You submit. If you have the means, go for Hajj, you submit to the call of Allah. If you have the means that you have to give zakat, then you submit to that command of Allah. And every other avenue that Allah has asked for. Now Allah explains, الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً. That Allah who has made for you the earth comfort, a bed, a such a mattress, such a surface that you can find ease in this earth. If Allah wanted, He could have made this earth so hard that we can't use it for anything. We can't use it for any sort of harvest. We can't use it for any sort of good use for us. But Allah has made this earth soft. Firasha. In the Arabic language, firasha, we normally use in this context today is mattress. And a mattress isn't hard. No one sleeps on a very, you know, hard, stiff mattress. Rasulullah did. When he used to sleep on his straw mattress, when he used to wake up, the, you know, those the signs and the marks that are left behind because of the date palm leaves, that was left on the back of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But today, firash, mattress, is something soft. You find ease and comfort in it. You have a good night's sleep with this mattress. So Allah says, I have made the whole earth a means of comfort and peace for you, a means of goodness. وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءَ. And I have made the heaven, the sky, a roof for you. Roof from what? Today, because as science develops, we realize a few points. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made 7 layers of our atmosphere, of our heaven. And these 7 layers, from them, one of them is known as the ozone layer, which is the closest one to us. If that is damaged, then the sun rays are more stronger than what they need to be, due to which people have skin cancer, due to which people, they suffer certain illnesses because of the heat and the excessive heat of the sun. So Allah says, we've made this sky such a roof for you. Because what does a roof do? It protects you from the rain. It protects you from cold. Allah says, we've made this heaven of ours such a roof. It protects you from all those things from outside space that can potentially harm you. For example, if you were to understand rain. When rain falls down from the heaven and the clouds form together, then rain initially, it's not the way it falls down now what we see. It's actually more of an ice, more like a rock form. It's very thick and very hard and very big. But as it gradually falls through the heavens, before it comes to the surface of the earth, it becomes raindrops and then it falls down. If Allah wanted, if Allah did not have this roof and these layers of the heavens, then if these raindrops were to be actually not drops, rather big stones, they were to fall down, then no one will be able to survive on the face of this earth. So we'll all be destroyed by the mere rain. But Allah, by creating these layers and creating this roof, He has actually protected us from His own creation. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says that, do you not think, O people, you have intellect? As time goes on and as we're going closer and closer to the day of Qiyamah, and technology is advancing and science is advancing, have we not thought for once that this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is protecting us? This sky of His has become a roof from the harms of the sun. We all know that as soon as we, the human being, pollute the world, we are destroying the ozone layer. We are destroying the parts of the heavens. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we are created as a roof. Science says if the sun was to be 1 inch closer to the earth, then no civilization will be able to exist on the face of this earth. If it was 1 inch more further away, then it would be too cold for the human being, for animals and for civilization to prosper on the face of this earth. So Allah has made everything precise. And Allah says, you don't need to be a Muslim to understand this. You just need to have some sort of intellect. So our deen isn't based on emotion. Our deen is based on the study. The first command of Allah was Iqra, read. From this we understand that the book of Allah and the teachings of Islam isn't just based on hearsay. Some aspects are, you have to accept without any sort of questioning. But when Allah says, find me, then look towards His creation, you will definitely find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah continues to say, وَأَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. And from the sky, we have sent water down. Why does Allah specifically mention water? For life to prosper, every living thing needs water. This is why those of you that will be reading your articles regarding Mars and other planets, the first thing that they look for any chance of life, is they look for ice/water. If there is water, if there is ice, then there is that possibility of life being there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and from the heavens we send down water to you. That one thing that the rest of the creations are looking towards in other planets. If, is there water? Is there water? Water means life. So Allah says, we have sent you water from the heavens, فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ رِزْقًا لَكُمْ, through which it falls onto the ground, and then you have fruits that become your provisions. If we look into our food, if we look deep down the root of where all our food comes from, it comes from the earth. Whatever you may take. Take an animal, for instance, those the meat that we eat and we consume, it's from the grass. It eats the grass, it eats the hay, etc. From the ground, from the water, it goes inside, it allows the animal to grow, and then that comes to our plate. Look at every sort of vegetation, it's through the water, through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding water. There is another verse of Allah in the Quran where Allah says, خَلَقَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مِنْ مَا. We have created everything from water. Scientists, when they heard regarding this verse of the glorious Quran, they looked into it. That how is it possible that everything is created from water? Because we find that some things, you know, it's possible there's no water. A human being has water content. Does everything have it? Yes, it does. There is a book which is called The Amazing Facts of the Glorious Quran. Within that, it explains that this verse of the glorious Quran, when Allah says everything has been created from water, to understand this, we have to understand a concept where every animal and every source of bacteria has plasma. And in our blood, we have plasma. If you're cold-blooded reptiles, they have plasma. Hot-blooded like us, we have plasma inside our blood. Plasma, the statistics say that 99% of plasma is water. 99% of plasma is water. So every living thing inside it, it has plasma and it has water inside. It has a water content. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Life is based on water. Allah even describes that the semen of a man, it is a form of water. Allah has created you from water also. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this. So Allah says, O human being, do you not think? Do you not think that you're seeing all these blessings around you? You still don't understand? For example, our eyelashes and our eyebrows, the exact same chemical structure of our hairs here and our hairs on our head. Only a space of approximately 5 centimeters. Approximately 5 centimeters difference, this hair will continue to grow. But these eyelashes and these eyebrows stop growing. Scientifically, there is no answer. What answer? There is no answer. It's the same structure of the hair here and the hair here. But this, if you were to shave it off, it'll grow back to a certain length and it'll stop. These eyelashes will stop. But Allah says, look, just look in your own body. Look towards your own body and see how we have created you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qiyamah, on the day of Qiyamah, we will resurrect you to the tip of your fingers. Only in the last 200 years, not even 200 years, have we come to realize that every human being has his own, very unique fingertip and fingerprints. Allah said this in the glorious Quran. So we've already showed you this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so many places in the glorious Quran, He explains that, O human being, look, do you not see on this earth so much we have done for you? That when you have a seed and you plant it inside the ground and you place the water, that's where your human interaction stops. Who is the one that allows that seed to start growing? You don't see that power. You don't have any might towards that. You look towards a grand oak tree or an apple tree. That same oak tree and the apple tree is tied off with one small seed. From that small seed, a great tree grew. You had no human interaction. You merely placed the water, you merely put the soil there. But what happened under that soil was the doing of the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, O human being, look towards these things. Look at your body. When you have a scab and your body starts to heal and the skin starts to heal around and it starts to protect your body and it starts to form new skin all over again under the scab. So when you take off the scab, you have new skin. Who is the one doing this? Whilst you're going away through your day and you don't know what's going on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is working His way. when, you know, the human being, when the mother is expecting a child. Yeah, you can do all your scans. Yeah, you can have a check on the child. Is he a boy or a girl? But who is allowing that child to grow? Who is allowing that child to form? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All human interaction stops. Human interaction is to a certain point. Everything stops. Look towards that being who says, الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً وَأَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. That we have sent for you water from these heavens so that you may find your provisions. All food comes from the earth. Every sort of food, animal, be it an animal, be it vegetation, it is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the blessing of water. Now Allah says, فَلَا تَجَارِبْ لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. Don't. Allah is commanding us. Negative command. Don't. Don't make a partner with Allah. Don't make anyone parallel to Allah. فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And you know it. Here Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, the master of tafsir, says that you know this. Who is Allah referring to? The disbelievers and the hypocrites. That you know. Look at the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a doctor from the Czech. He said it was available on YouTube. I don't know if it's still available. But where he says that, I was looking into Islam. And after looking into Islam, I was pondering that, how is this religion true? Is this book honestly and truly the book of Allah? Because I went home with the Czech Republican translation of the glorious Quran. And I just opened on a random page to see, he's a doctor, to see if this is truly the book of Allah. He goes, I opened it on a page and it happened to be Suratul Hajj, which is found in the 17th juz of the Quran, verse number 5, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives such a fine detail regarding the embryonic system, where the child starts to grow inside the mother, and how it starts off with a clot of blood, and then Allah allows the bones, Allah allows structure, Allah allows organs to come. And the order that Allah narrates it is the exact order which actually takes place and really happens. So this doctor says, how can Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam 1400 years ago know about this? It's not possible. There was nothing for you to examine what's happening inside that mother. Not possible for any sort of technology, any equipment to measure what's happening inside. He says, definitely this has to be the words of the Creator Allah. It has to be an external being, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these signs Allah says, don't make a partner with me. فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. When you know the truth. But Allah doesn't stop there. Now Allah is going to give me and you the greatest challenge that any author has ever put in any book. If I was to write a book and I was to say in that book, that look, I'm writing such a book that there is no doubt inside this book of mine. You won't be able to question my book. I have written in such a way, none of you will be able to write like me. I'll be seen as a very arrogant person and the whole world will go against me to challenge my statement. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also makes this statement. Allah says, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِّمَّا نَزَّلْنَا. If you are in any sort of doubt regarding that which we have revealed, عَلَىٰ عَبَدِنَا, towards our servant. Here the ulama stop. Here definitely everyone agrees this is regarding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our servant is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah here could have said, عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّنَا, upon our prophet. That which, if you are in any doubt regarding that which we have sent down to our Prophet, or to our beloved, or to our messenger. But here, why does Allah decide to use the word that what we have sent to our servant? From this, the ulama explain that from the moment and go, Rasulullah is also a servant. He has no interaction with these words. These are solely and exclusively the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've merely sent it on our servant. He isn't the one that's making this up. He's a servant of ours. We have chosen our servant for this. The ulama say the greatest title for anyone is to be known as the servant of Allah. Wherever in the Quran Allah refers to Rasulullah as a servant, it as an abd, as Allah's servant, it is for a very, 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 very high and a very noble task. For example, Subhanalladhi asara bi'abdihi. Glorified is that Allah who took his servant on a night journey. In Surah Al-Kahf, Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. All praises to Allah who has revealed this book to his servant. the greatest title for any person is to be the servant of Allah. That's why in our Shahada we say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. And we testify that Muhammad is first and foremost the servant of Allah. Thereafter he is the messenger of Allah. Ayyub alayhi salam. Allah says that ni'mal abd. What a very beautiful servant of ours. Allah talks about Ibrahim, Ismail, Ishaq. What beautiful servants of ours they are. Isa alayhi salam, when he spoke whilst he was in his cradle, the first thing he said, Inni, he said, Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam says, Inni abdullah, that I am the servant of Allah. Before anything, before being a prophet, before being anything special, I am only the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah loves this status of being servant. On the day of Qiyamah, Allah, in front of the whole of His creation, He will look towards the servant and He will say to him, Hada abdi, this is my servant, the one that displeased the rest of creation, who displeased everyone and everything just to please me. He is my servant. Allah will honor him with the title of servant. And that is the pinnacle of our lives. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created you, O human being, O jinn kind, I have not created you, but that you worship me, just so that you become my banda, my abd, my servant. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us. So Allah says, if you are in any doubt regarding that thing that which we have sent to our servant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from this we understand risalat, prophethood, that Allah is sending this to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He isn't saying, making you up. Everything that Rasulullah speaks, in huwa illa wahyu yuha. Everything that Rasulullah says, everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is revelation. To the extent the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also a form of revelation, but that it's not the part of the book of Allah. The book of Allah is wahiyya matlu, that which is recited, and the hadith is wahiyya ghayra matlu, that which is not recited, that which is known as the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But that still is revelation. But Allah says, if you're in any doubt, then Allah gives a challenge that to this day no one has been able to fulfill. Allah says, Fa'tu bi suratin min mithli. Bring one chapter, one surah, min mithli, in the same sort of way, in the same style as that which we have inside this book of ours. Bring any chapter. To this day, humanity can come together. They have never been able to succeed. Do you know what Allah says? Allah doesn't say to every individual when they read this verse that bring a chapter. Allah says, no. Wadu'u shuhada'akum. Don't start pondering about trying to make up a chapter by yourself. Wadu'u shuhada'akum. You know what? Call all of your witnesses. Call all of your helpers. To the extent the ulama explain what witnesses. Allah is saying to me and you, call the whole of mankind. Call the whole of jinn kind. Call the whole of malaika, the angels of Allah. Bring all of the creation of Allah on one platform. All of you come together. Try to bring a chapter like that, the chapter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the challenge of Allah. To the extent when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the Kaaba, Inna a'tayna, was written, Inna a'tayna kal kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, Inna shani'aka huwal abdar, laysa al kalamu min al bashar. This cannot be a poet while seeing these three verses of Inna Ata'ina. He reads it and then he adds saying, Laysa al-kalamu min al-bashar. This cannot be the words of a man. This cannot be the words of a man. It is not possible for it to be the words of a man. How do we know this? This book of Allah that we see in front of us, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was not in book form. Rasulullah, this Quran was revealed in a period of 23 years spoken. How can we say that this is not the words of Allah? Rasulullah in 23 years, myself and yourself in 23 minutes, we can't even remember the order of what we're saying. We can't even remember the order of what we say. Rasulullah has been given this in a period of 23 years. The first day he recited, Ikra, Bismi Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq. On the end of his 23 years, he is still reciting Ikra Bismi Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq in the same order, in the same verses, in the same pronunciation. Everything is intact. And it's still not in book form. Only in recent times, i.e. when technology has advanced and we've put the Quran Kareem inside a database, we've put it inside a structure where you've typed it up on the internet, you've typed up the Arabic language, have people started to study the Quran now? Before, people didn't. It was in book form at the time of Abu Bakr, then Umar, and then finally completed at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. But people didn't explore the Quran. They believed in the Quran. How do we know it cannot be any sort of convention and any sort of interaction from the mankind and from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Just ponder over a few points. These are points that I've gathered from Ustad Nu'man Ali Khan and points that are mentioned in the books of Tafsir. For example, in the Quran Kareem, we all accept that when it was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was not in book form. It was on the tongue of Rasulullah, and parts of the Quran were memorized by the Huffaz and other parts were written down. Now that we've got the Quran and we can put it through a filtration, through a system where we can try to find out some matching phrases, matching words, if we look deep into the Quran, this was not in book form, now it's in book form, it's in its true form. We find that if you look in the Quran, for example, the word ad-dunya, the word dunya, world, comes in the glorious Quran 115 times. It comes in the Quran 115 times. The word akhirah, which is the hereafter, also comes 115 times. We find in the Quran that malaika, angels of Allah, comes 88 times. The opposite of the malaika is shaitan, shayateen, that also comes 88 times in the glorious Quran. We find in the Quran Allah mentions life, haya, 145 times.
That's not true. That's not true.
It's not true? Why?
That life one and death one
is
not true.
It's not true. Okay then. I'm quoting from that, so I'll leave them on.
I've seen the video. Just one or two mistakes.
The good deeds one, 167 times, and say yet?
You don't check that one.
So there's the one of the good deeds, 167 times, good deeds and bad deeds. Belief is true. I myself have checked this. Iman and Kufr come 17 times in the glorious Quran. Both come together. The word shaitan, Iblis, comes 11 times in the Quran. Iblisu. And a'udhu billahi, and a'udhu bika, and a'udhu min ash-shaytan comes 17 times in the glorious Quran. Also the phrase of asking protection from the shaitan. This is amazing. In the Quran Kareem, the word shahr, month. How many months are there that we know? 12. The word month, shahr, comes 12 times in the glorious Quran. So if we look into the Quran, we will find these very beautiful matches that take place. Why is that there? Because the Quran is not my work, it's not your work. It's not the work of anyone, but the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has no any sort of relation that he himself can add to this. No. The book of Allah in its form is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to this day, no one has been able to challenge Allah on this statement. People have tried. We find that some poets came later and they tried to put a surah on the measure and on the rhythm of Al-Qariya. What did the man say? Rather than saying Al-Qariya, he said, Al-Filu, Mal-Filu. Do you know what the elephant is? Shall I tell you regarding the elephant? You know, bakwas, you know, nothing that makes sense. No poetry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he speaks in the glorious Quran, he speaks in such a way that everything has power and everything makes sense. Al-Qariya, the devastating time. Mal-Qariya, what is this devastating thing that will come to you all? وَمَا دَرَاكَ مَالْقَارِيَ. Do you know regarding this thing? Allah builds a whole, this intense feeling and this tension. Allah speaks in this way. Not only is the Quran beautiful in its actual wording, look at its recitation. Look at the recitation of tartil. When a person masters his tajweed and masters qira'ah, and he learns to pray the glorious Quran in a method and in such a way, where even in the words of the glorious Quran we find greatness. It said regarding Qari Abdul Basit, he went to Russia and he recited the glorious Quran in front of a meeting room, in front of some Russian government people, and after reciting, from amongst them, some accepted Islam, just on the mere recitation of the glorious Quran. The Quran itself has such an effect that it's a recitation without understanding. Ask people how they feel. So many, you know, those YouTube tests where they go around and they make you listen to the glorious Quran has a soothing effect. Why? Because this is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah challenges the whole of mankind, the whole of His creation. that if you have any doubt regarding this book, then know that it is not from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that bring whoever you want, min dunillah, except for Allah obviously. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not assist you in this, in kuntum sadiqeen. If you yourself think yourselves to be truthful, if you think that you are on the truth, that you are on the true path, then Allah gives you this challenge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, He continues with this challenge, and Allah Himself will say something regarding this challenge, inshallah, in the next verse to come, which we will, inshallah, discuss, if Allah gives tawfiq, inshallah, next week. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me and you the tawfiq to understand the message of the glorious Quran. The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes with a message of tawheed, that believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Accept Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Know that there is a life after this life. There is the akhirah coming in front of me and you. We need to accept this, we need to understand this. And more so, we need to learn to have tadabbur in the glorious Quran. That this Quran isn't only for the scholar or for the alim or for the hafiz. It's for every single person. So, you know, sometimes sitting down with the glorious Quran, looking into the translation, but be very careful. Mere translation without understanding what this verse is regarding and the order of the glorious Quran, a person will become confused. This Quran has been placed in an order where some verses, to understand them, you will have to look deep into the Quran at different stages and different verses. In one verse you'll find in the Quran, Allah says that don't drink alcohol when you're going for salah. So does that mean you're allowed to drink alcohol? No, there's different stages where Allah Ta'ala eliminated alcohol and made alcohol haram in the glorious Quran. So mere translation, if you were to open only Surah Baqarah, you will not understand the glorious Quran. To understand the Quran, you need to have a lifelong journey with the Quran. You have to have far more vast understanding. You have to have understanding of the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The greatest commentary of the Quran is the Quran itself. The Quran, it supports its verses. And thereafter, the second commentary of the glorious Quran is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, wherein Rasulullah himself has explained certain verses. Surah Al-Baqarah is a very, very special surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, explains to me and you that if a person merely recites the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, kafahu, it is enough for him for the rest of the night. وآمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون أحاديث صحيح بخاري صحيح مسلم. It will be enough for a person. We also find regarding Surah Al-Baqarah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that indeed in the house wherein Surah Al-Baqarah is recited, shaitan and magic and mischief cannot affect that house. So we find so many barakah. When a person moves into a new home, a person should make a point to recite Surah Al-Baqarah in one sitting. If not in one sitting, then at least before the whole family moves in, the whole of Surah Al-Baqarah should be recited. And if a person is having trouble in their home, even after living in whichever home they're living in, they should try to recite Surah Al-Baqarah. It will become a means of barakah, inshallah. May the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the tawfiq to understand. Allah leaves with a challenge. If you think you can gather and you can bring something equivalent to the glorious Quran, then come with it. Allah will answer regarding this challenge. Such an author who gives a challenge and then he tells you that you can't fulfill his challenge. This from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah, the Arabs were known. The greatest miracle of Islam at that time was the language. Because every other time, it was Isa alayhi salam, when he came at that time, it was those people who were mastering medicine, those that started to learn about tib, herbal remedies, and those that can cure people. So Allah sent his Rasul, Isa alayhi salam, to tackle this. And Hazrat Isa alayhi salam was able to, through the power of Allah, bi-idhnillah, he was allowed to give back sight. He was allowed to cure the leprosy. He was allowed to cure those that were disabled, etc. When the Quran came, the peak of civilization was in the concentration of language, where the Arabic language was so fasih and so vast and so beautiful, that if anything can challenge it, it has to be something from above. So Rasulullah ﷺ, who ummi, illiterate, one that he himself could not read or write, Allah sent this glorious Quran through him. We find regarding Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he accepted Islam, one of the most accepted and the most biggest narration is where his sister and his brother-in-law were reciting Quran, and he went to their home. But from amongst that, there is a verse in Surah Al-Haqqa. Hazrat Umar says that when I was becoming inclined to deen, once I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was in front of the Kaaba offering salah, and I could hear him recite some verses. I was listening, and the first thing that came to my mind was, he's a poet. He's too, you know, amazing in what he's saying. He must be a poet. As soon as I thought that, the next verse that Rasulullah said was, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَاعِرٍ. This is not the words of a poet. قَلِيلًا مَا تُؤْمِنُونَ. Only a few will believe. Only a few of you believe. Then he says, when this verse, I heard that verse, I thought, he must be a magician. How can he know that I'm thinking this? The next verse is, وَلَا بِقَوْلِ كَاهِنٍ. These are not the words of a magician or a soothsayer either. قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Only a few of you actually take advice. And he was thinking, that what can he be? تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. This is something from the رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar radiallahu ta'ala says, this is when the spark of Iman had entered my heart. And I realized, this cannot be anything but the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I pray Allah ta'ala gives me and you the tawfiq to understand. I pray that Allah ta'ala forgives us for all of our wrongs. This is the book of Allah, and in reality, I myself, I am not in any way capable in knowledge, in my own spirituality, in my own life to be speaking regarding the book of Allah. Rather, I see as a mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a chance for me to mend my ways and become a better person. I pray that we make a personal relationship with the glorious Quran. When I completed my Hibs Quran, it was a 4-year journey, and alhamdulillah, I've had this Quran for over 20 years now, my actual Quran. And whenever I read it now, because there's memories and flashbacks of when I read a few paras and I memorized para 5 and what I was going through, and, you know, school days and memories, good memories, bad memories, where I was, you know, I did good things and bad things, and everything is there. And when you feel hurt and you don't have no one to talk to, and then, you know, you just want to zone out. So I start playing my Quran, because, you know, I thought I'll go over my own Quran. So I'd open my Quran at home and I'd look through my Quran, and all these memories come through, and then I realize that through all the ups and downs, the thing that's been there for me all the way through my life is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even now, like when I'm upset, when I'm angry, when I'm not happy with something, well, the way I zone out is I'll go to my room, I'll pick up my Quran, I'll start reciting my Quran, and then you realize if there's any true friend in your life, it is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ahlul Qur'ani hum Ahlullah. The people of the Qur'an, they are the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you connect yourself to the words of Allah, in reality you're connecting yourself to the author of that word, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I pray that Allah makes us amongst the people of Qur'an. I pray that Allah allows me and you, those of us that are shown with tajweed, reciting the Qur'an. We should make an effort with reciting the Qur'an. Those of us that know how to recite the Qur'an properly, next step, start memorizing chapters of the Quran, Surah Al-Mulk, Surah Sajidah, Surah Yasin, etc. Those of you that have done that, now advance more. Try to understand the message of the Quran. And more so for everyone, if we understand the Quran or not, let us all act upon the Quran. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was asked, مَا خُلِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. What is the character of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم? She replied, هَلْ قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنِ. Have you not recited the Quran? O person, have you not recited the Quran? The person said, yes. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala says, خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. That the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Quran. He was the physical exegesis. So when Allah says, offer salah, how do you offer salah? Look into the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says, become humble in your way of approach and in your walking. يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ حَوْنَا. Where do you learn how to become humble? Look towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says, thou praise Allah, repent to Allah, look into the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They both come together, the man of Allah, meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the book of Allah, they come hand in hand. You cannot hold the Quran and say that I don't need the Sunnah. You cannot hold the Sunnah and say I don't need the Quran. They both complement each other, and they both come in hand in hand. So the more closer you become to the Quran, you become closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The more closer you become to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you become closer to the Quran, and both you are actually become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I pray Allah accepts it. Please make dua of me. Allah give me health. I don't feel too well. And Allah ta'ala keep us all safe.